Black Power and the Civil Rights Movement of the late 50s and the 60s was the prototype of every single liberation movement in this country that we are still dealing with.
The crowd occupies every inch on the lawns and under the trees, and there's a great swell of cheers to welcome Martin Luther King to the speaker's podium, a man who stands as a symbol of all they are fighting for.
I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its creed.
African Americans said no more. They refused to hide behind the stereotypes that we were supposed to have. And we said, no good. No good. You know? And then everybody got the feeling, whatever their oppression was, well, maybe I don't have to take this either.
I think that the connections between black liberation and women's liberation and gay liberation are very deep. Many of us who went south to work with Dr. King in the 60s were gay. I remember a plane going down from Chicago. There were six priests and three of us were gay. A lot of gay people who could not come out for their own liberation could invest those same energies in the liberation of black people.
You need to begin with a movement, which is what Black Power and the Civil Rights Movement was. Then, immediately within it, you are going to get those people whose differences are not being articulated, which is, right, us. So then there is immediately another step.
In the 60s, there was a distinct change in the temper and the tempo of the gay movement, partly as a result of the Black Civil Rights Movement militancy. We began to get more militant in the gay movement. We began to see that the problem of homosexuality is not really gay people's problem. It's a problem of the social attitudes of the people around us. And we had to change their attitudes, and that in turn would help us with our self-image.
And the white gay people who had an investment in the civil rights movement had the experience by then of liberation movement, of confrontational techniques, of nonviolent struggle, and began to use them, these same techniques, on behalf of their own movement.
1965 was our big picketing year. We had marched across the street and proceeded to picket right over there for 2 hours. We had no idea what the police would do or how they would behave, so we scheduled the whole thing without any notice to anybody, and nothing happened. Nobody threw rocks at us. It was magnificently successful. And the State Department, of course, had been really zeroed in on by McCarthy a good 12, 15 years before, and that's where more firings, I think, had occurred than any other one single agency. And so we felt it was appropriate to picket. By that time, we had our procedures down pat, and we had sent out a news release a week or so in advance, and by sheer good luck, Secretary of State Rusk was having a news conference the night before.
Well, I understand that we're being picketed by a group of homosexuals. The policy of the department is that we do not employ homosexuals knowingly, and that if we discover homosexuals in our department, we discharge them.
One of the major successes of the gay movement in the 1960s was our breakthrough into mainstream publicity.
According to Kinsey's estimate, there are about 200,000 homosexuals in the Los Angeles area. We're going to talk about those people tonight and about the problem they present to the community at large. You'll hear from a psychiatrist, a police official, and a homosexual. Name, please?
Curtis White.
Your occupation?
I'm an office worker.
Are you a homosexual, Mr. White?
Yes.
I'd like to ask you, does your family know that you're a homosexual?
They didn't until tonight.
Do you think they're likely to learn about your homosexuality as a result of this program?
I'm almost certain they will. And I'm quite certain that I will probably lose my job as a result of the program, too.
Well, then may I ask why you agreed to appear on this program?
I hope that through this means I can be of some use to someone else other than myself.
As much publicity as possible, that was the whole idea, to crack that shield of invisibility that had always made it difficult for us to get our message across.
The majority of gay people in the 60s were terribly concerned with the image of the homosexual.
The men had to wear suits and ties, and the women all had to wear dresses and heels. I think nylons even. The more conservative elements, their basic feeling was, well, we're fighting the federal government for jobs, therefore we have to look employable by the federal government.
many of us accepted the idea that if we dressed properly, if we behaved properly, if we didn't make waves, if we didn't draw attention to ourselves, people would accept us by not knowing who we were. And we gradually, some of us, began to take the position that we had to assert ourselves.
One of the more militant assertions put forward by Frank Kameny and other homosexual leaders was the idea that gay people were not mentally ill. Even within the movement, this concept provoked intense debate.
It created quite a stir. It's hard for young people today to imagine, as little as 20 years ago, 100 gay people sitting around arguing over whether or not they should say that they weren't mentally ill.
We can debate what is an illness or whether it is an illness or not. I happen to subscribe to the belief that it is a tragic illness, a neurosis the same as many other neuroses.
Every psychiatric viewpoint treated homosexuality as psychologically pathological. I taught that viewpoint until I learned better.
Homosexuality, as it was still called by the therapist, was a character disorder. My only hope of achieving, quote, health, and my only hope of having a happy life was to change my sexual orientation. And for, as I remember it, nearly 2 years, I not only went without sex, but I gave up a lover, a man I had been seeing at the time, under the pressure of the group.
And see, this process that you go through as a young lesbian of finding everything in society not fitting you, you have a choice to become sick and mentally ill or to trust yourself and fly with that. Well, I decided to trust myself and fly with that.
The assumption is that women shouldn't like math. They shouldn't like science. They're supposed to like only home economics. When there are hundreds of thousands of women all over this country and all over the world who happen to like things they're not supposed to like, and the day is coming, we're going to like them, we're going to do them, we're going to take our freedom by any means necessary.
I think the women's movement provided a safe haven for a lot of women who were struggling with their sexuality and might not have even known they were struggling with their sexuality.
Now, I didn't stay home and cook and have babies and marry a man and didn't identify in particular with people who did.
They knew that there was something different about them and they didn't quite fit out there in that heterosexual world. And so they came into, came into the women's movement. Part of me came because the politics sounded right. But there was a secret little part that said, maybe I'll find a woman to love. And I think that happened for a lot of women. I know that many lesbians were the early beginnings of NOW. And NOW was the women's movement then. I mean, that was it. There was nothing else. And yes, the lesbians were in the forefront of the very beginning of NOW. And still are. Except nobody knows it.
When the hippies came along, it was a real liberating thing because they started wearing whatever they wanted to. And then that made gay people feel freer to do likewise.
The Flower Children came along in 1967, right, and turned into the hippie movement. And in one given day, bouffant hairstyles went out and everyone was ironing their hair. I mean, it was, boom, boom.
The role playing was not as obvious. It wasn't important. Everybody was just sort of turning into being a guy. I think one of the things that I realized, in order for me to be homosexual, it didn't mean that I was woman's replacement. It didn't mean that I had to be femme. It just meant that I was a guy who liked guys.
And then all of a sudden, Time magazine comes out with this article, San Francisco, the city of love. There's free love on the street.
Don't you want no part of the love? Don't you need some part of the love? Won't you love some part of the love? You gotta find some part of the love.
Yeah, it was a fascinating period, actually. There was an organization called the Psychedelic Venus Church in Berkeley, which was a gay church, and that organization used to co-sponsor parties in the city, and they were orgies, basically. You would walk in, and you could take your clothes off and kind of put them in a bag. There'd be wine, people would bring their grass in and what have you. A very, very new scene, certainly new to me, and quite fascinating.
The revolution in this country is, in fact, people coming forth
demand freedom.
The latter part of the 60s, in gradually escalating fashion, were a period of enormous ferment.
All we are saying,
it was a period of enormous social turmoil, which had its impact, of course, on gays as well. We were living in the larger society.
In the black community, it was really bad because almost every time you would walk out of the house, you were being stopped. I really think that it was the young gays that were putting up the biggest fight. And it was sort of like, well, I guess it's okay to fight.
Act of political feeling, especially among young people. And of course, when the night of the Stonewall riots came along, just everything came together at that one moment. People quite often ask, well, what was special about that night, Friday, June 27th, 1969? There was no one thing that was special about it. It was just everything coming together. One of those moments in history where, and if you were there, you just knew, this is it. This is what we've been waiting for.
They decided, you know, we've had enough of this kind of thing. We're going to fight back. The patrons, instead of timidly taking it, they actually hurled rocks and bottles right back at the police. And the rioting went on for a couple of days.
The Stonewall coming all the way up and down and in across the bottom.
Well, the next few nights really were a repetition of the rioting.
All of a sudden, a lot of gay people would appear on the streets. In this whole area, not just in front of the Stonewall.
Fire alarm boxes were pulled, trash cans were set on fire.
So there was a chance of gay power, I remember that.
And they felt the injustice, and it was that expression of feeling that radiated across the country.
It gave me the courage to also come out and say no more as far as my work was concerned, as far as my private life is concerned. And that's what I really became a gay activist, and it was helped by that movement. The spirit of that movement carried all the way out to the West Coast. Wouldn't you agree, Morris?
Yes, Paul.
Yes, yes.
I'm gay and I'm proud. I'll sing it aloud. I'm not afraid to be me anymore. Tell your sister, tell your brother, it's okay to love one another. Sing it aloud. I'm gay and I'm proud.
The tide really turned at the time of Stonewall. A large number of gay people who had not known about the movement before heard about it and said, I'm going to join this, or I'm going to start something of my own.
Oh, I'm not afraid to be me. Tell your sister, tell your brother, it's okay to love one another. Sing it aloud, I'm gay and I'm proud.
By joining and uniting all of us, we have really gained power. And even in small communities, whether it's a Kalamazoo or Timbuktu, our voices are heard there. And from the time of Stonehenge to Stonewall, this has been the struggle, and we're winning.
Before Stonewall and After Stonewall, two films about gay and lesbian life in America are now available on home video. Call 1-800-255-9424 to order your copies today.